नमस्कार। राजपथ में कई नए मोड़ आ गए हैं और बजट, इकोनॉमी और पॉलिटिक्स तीनों पर इस वक्त बहुत गर्म बहस है। फिर से एक बार समझने के लिए और एक फ्रेश पर्सपेक्टिव के लिए हम बात कर रहे हैं पूर्व वित्त और विदेश मंत्री पी चिदम्बरम साहब से। सर, आपने हमारे लिए वक्त निकाला, आपका बहुत शुक्रिया। सबसे पहले तो ये कि सबको पता है कि इकोनॉमी की हालत बहुत ख़राब है, लेकिन बजट बिल्कुल सामने है, तो निर्मला सीतारमण की मदद की जाए, उनको कुछ सजेशन दे दिए जाए सर आपकी तरफ से।
नो, आई एम नॉट कॉम्पिटेंट टू एडवाइज मिस निर्मला सीतारमण। इवन व्हाट वी से इन पार्लियामेंट शी डिसमिसेस अस विद अटर कंटेंप्ट। शी डजंट टेक एनी आवर सजेशंस, शी डजंट लिसन टू आवर सजेशंस, शी डजंट फाइंड एनी मेरिट इन एनीथिंग दैट एनी ऑपोजिशन पार्टी सेज। So why should we give her suggestions? She knows best.
Still, if we ask you to, what is your expectation from the budget this time? Because it is very challenging economic numbers that we are seeing all around us. So we ought to advise them how to do.
No, why should we advise them? Have they asked our advice? Have they called us for a discussion?
सर, एक चीज़ आपने बड़ा इंटरेस्टिंग नोटिस किया होगा कि इस वक्त प्राइम मिनिस्टर ने खुद बहुत हाई प्रोफाइल बहुत सारी मीटिंग्स की हैं इंडस्ट्री के साथ, सेक्टोरल एक्सपर्ट्स के साथ, इकोनॉमिस्ट के साथ, और ठीक बजट के पहले किया। तो जाहिर है कि एक्सपेक्टेशन बन रही है कि पीएम हैंड्स ऑन है बजट मेकिंग को लेकर के, तो हो सकता है कि सरप्राइज कर दें।
इट्स टू लेट। आई हैव आल्सो हर्ड अबाउट दिस मीटिंग विद 12 इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट। नो ऑफिसर्स, बिना ऑफिसर only he was there, but all that I gather is he didn't speak. He made some introductory remark saying, I'm sorry, I did not meet you for many months, I'm inviting you now to speak your mind, take as much time as you want and please speak freely. Then he listened to them for 2 hours. At the end he said, I've heard you, I will give it my best attention. Now from that, what do you make out what is going on in his mind? Number two, these meetings are too late. You can't hold a meeting on the 6th or 7th of January and then make a budget on the 1st of February. These meetings should have been held much earlier if you want to come up with any meaningful proposal. If you simply want some announcements to be made, of course they will make announcements. See, the year 2019-20 is lost. They can do nothing about this year. They can't remedy anything now. Although the year is up to March tak saal hai, kuch he can't do anything. This is over. This year is lost, a wasted year.
So what we hear that they will go for a tax cut, they will try to mobilize more revenue, they will encourage private investment.
But what have they been doing?
Consumption.
So what have they been doing all these last year? They said the same thing. We are giving corporate tax cut, we are going to spend more, we are going to encourage consumption. They've said the same thing. What is new about it? They've run out of ideas. They have no ideas at all.
हम लोग ये बात करते रहते हैं कि इकोनॉमी इतनी अगर ख़राब है तो किसी भी रूलिंग पार्टी को बहुत कंसर्न होना चाहिए, टेंशन होना चाहिए कि लोग नाराज़ हो जाएंगे, जॉब लॉसेस हो रहे हैं, बिजनेस नहीं चल रहा है। लेकिन डॉक्टर सुब्रमण्यम स्वामी ने इसको बहुत अच्छे से डिकोड कर दिया है। उनका कहना है इकोनॉमी से चुनाव जीते बीते नहीं जाते हैं, हिंदुत्व से जीते जाते हैं। हो सकता है हम जितने परेशान हो रहे हों, इस रूलिंग एस्टेब्लिशमेंट को इकोनॉमी बड़ा इशू लगता ही ना हो सर।
See, if they believe that they can win an election on Hindutva and therefore they neglect the economy, well, who am I to comment on it? It's sad. It's sad that elections are won or lost on Hindutva. The last election was won on Pulwama, Balakot, muscular, give a bloody nose to Pakistan. All right, you gave a bloody nose to Pakistan. So what? Pakistan has disappeared. Tensions have come down. There are no killings on the border. No civilians are killed. All this is somehow sways people. Ultimately, people will benefit only if you attend to the economy. Issues of livelihood, jobs, incomes, infrastructure, healthcare, education. Look at the quality of our education.
So, in the recent assembly elections, do you think that people got some kind of reality check and they have voted for the opposition parties? Does that give you some kind of sense?
You see, they are not voting for the Congress party or any other party, but they are certainly voting against the BJP.
But
that change has taken place. In Maharashtra, BJP expected to get 150 seats. They got 105. In Haryana, they expected to get some 75 seats or something. They ended up with getting 40. In Jharkhand, they said, we'll sweep the election.
But sir, don't you agree that state assembly elections for BJP is one thing?
Absolutely.
And Mr. Modi's Lok Sabha election is entirely different?
Correct. I entirely agree. I agree. I've been saying this. I agree. But if he loses election after election, see, there are 7 elections coming up. Delhi, Bihar, the next year, Kerala, Puducherry, Tamil Nadu, Bengal, Bihar is this year, Jammu Kashmir, Assam. If he uses election after election, then it will be very difficult to say that Mr. Modi's name alone will win a national election. It will still pull the BJP up. I'm not denying that. He's still got the pull factor. But if he loses state after state, some of that glamour, some of that sheen will wear away.
So, how do we read your own observations about that things are terrible and younger Indians are getting...
You can see that today. You see, please don't reduce this protest to anti-CAA.
Mm-hmm.
Anti-CAA is the, what we call the proximate cause. The immediate trigger is anti-CAA. But it's so uplifting, makes me so proud that so many young men and women, students and youths, cutting across religion, caste and language, are coming to fight for an intangible idea. Earlier you fight for tangible ideas, trade union protests for salary hike.
Some specific demand.
Roll back hostel fees. Postpone examinations. These are concrete, tangible. You know it's there. Today, they're fighting for intangible. Equality. Equal protection of the laws. No discrimination. Secularism. Liberal India. Pluralism. These can't be seen, these can't be touched. Intangible ideas. For that, they are willing to come and fight in this bitter cold of Delhi, braving police lathi and tear gas.
But what makes you believe that it will be sustained? Kyunki kai bar anger or ventilate kar diya apne apna frustration, expression aa gaya bahar, and then life goes back to normal.
Yes, it's possible. They may come to some settlement. They may forgive and reach some understanding on various issues. But they won't forget. They will remember. They will still remember the day police entered Jamia Millia. They will still remember the day when they entered, goons entered JNU. They will still remember that day. They won't forget.
Where is opposition in all this?
Opposition is there. Everybody is opposition, but they are not united. It was very sad that in the meeting called by the Congress party, or not called, arranged by the Congress party, let's say, there's no calling a party, arranged by the Congress party or encouraged to meet by the Congress party, 20 parties did participate. It's not a small number. But it is disappointing that the BSP, the SP, the TMC, the DMK, even Telugu Desam did not. Aam Aadmi, I didn't expect them to participate because there were elections around the corner. Now, they didn't participate. You say you're opposed to CAA. You say it's such a fundamental issue that it will break the idea of India. It's so basic, so fundamental that you'll have to come and struggle. But you don't participate in an opposition meeting. I'm afraid there's a question mark about your commitment to the issue.
इसको थोड़ा और एक्सपांड करें सर. बिल्कुल, मेरा भी यही सवाल है कि एक तरफ कह रहे हैं देश बहुत बड़े खतरे में है, अनप्रेसिडेंटेड चैलेंज आ गए हैं कंट्री के सामने, देश बदल जाएगा, इसको बचाओ सब लोग कह रहे हैं, और इस पर सब लोग एक ओपिनियन के भी हैं, फिर भी साथ में काम करने के लिए अगर एक नहीं हो रहे हैं तो इस एग्रेसिव बीजेपी को कोई चैलेंज नहीं है.
बहुत दुख है, इट्स रॉन्ग. यू सी, इफ द इश्यू वाज सो फंडामेंटल, the issue was so basic, so profound, so important.
Sir, you are being honest.
Then you should say, forget all these minor things. We are going to participate in an all-party meeting and pass that resolution. Mamta should have come. She should have come to the meeting. All right, locally I've got some problems with Congress and the CPM behind the Congress. I will deal with that later, but I will come to the meeting.
Sir, एक तरफ तो आप बहुत honest interpreter हो रहे हैं जो हुआ है उसका, लेकिन आपके मुँह से ये आ रहा है, मतलब थोड़ा सा pessimism का tone है कि you are a bit pessimistic about the current political context.
I'm worried that BJP is playing divide and rule,
and they are succeeding.
Well, I don't know whether they have succeeded, whether they have actually divided, I can't say, but they will play divide and rule.
Hmm.
You must not fall victim to the divide and rule.
Sir, you always speak your mind, that's why I'm asking this question. Many opposition parties and leaders, publicly, privately, they say that dealing with Congress party is extremely difficult. We don't know whom to deal with. And they always delay their decisions.
No, no, I also feel sometimes like that. But you have Mrs. Gandhi there at the president. And then you have a General Secretary organization. You have the leader of the opposition in the Rajya Sabha, Ghulam Nabi Azad. Then you have the treasurer, Ahmed Patel. I think these are the people you have to deal with at the national level. The general secretaries in charge of states can deal with the state level problems. But when it comes to national level, I think you'll have to deal with Mrs. Gandhi, Mr. Rahul Gandhi, Mr. Ghulam Nabi Azad, Mr. K.C. Venugopal, Mr. Ahmed Patel. These are the four or five people I suppose you will have to deal with.
Should we not then conclude that if Indian political situation today has presented a good opportunity for any opposition party, and Congress is the main opposition party, Congress is very happy and okay to lose it?
No, no, I don't think we are happy to lose it. I think we are struggling to find a way to pull all this together. Sometimes the Congress party succeeds, sometimes the Congress party fails. But I don't think it's for lack of effort. I think Mrs. Gandhi is passionately committed to the idea of a liberal, secular, free, plural, democratic India. She's very worried that this country is going on the fascist path. She wants all political parties to come together. Not necessarily under the Congress's leadership in every state. We are not the leader in Tamil Nadu. We are not the leader in Bihar. We are not the leader in Maharashtra. But we are the leader of opposition in Kerala, in Karnataka, in Assam, in Madhya Pradesh, in Rajasthan. We are the leader. Therefore, in some places we are the leader, in some places we are not the leader. Where we are not the leader, the Congress party is willing to play second fiddle to some other party, for example, in Jharkhand. But where we are the leader, we should play the captain. So others must accept that we are the captain in some states. We must accept that we are not the captain in many other states.
Simple. Coming back to CAA NRC, NPR. You were Home Minister then, and NPR was to roll out, to be rolled out. So what is wrong with NPR?
Nothing wrong with NPR. It is the content and the context which are different. NPR 2010 was not our idea. The census commissioner was going to do a census in 2011. So he came to us and said, the law requires me to do an NPR. I'm going to do a census anyway next year. Why don't you do the NPR now that leads into the census? Because all that you collect for NPR has to be collected for census anyway. So we said, fine, do it, save some money. The UIDAI was doing the Aadhaar. They came and said, why should the census commissioner do for all the states? Let us do for some states. There were differences. UIDAI was collecting information only under 5 items. NPR was collecting information under 15 items. So we said, all right, you do half the states, you do half the states. So census commissioner did NPR on only half the states. And that led into the census. Once the census was done in 2011, we stopped. We didn't go further. We didn't do NRC. We didn't even talk about NRC. We didn't even whisper the words NRC. Today, the content is different because they are not asking information about 15 items alone. They are asking about many more items. What is your last place of residence? What is the place of birth of your father? What is the place of birth of your mother? What is your passport number? What is your voter ID number? What is your PAN? Why are they asking all this? What has this got to do with usual place of residence? Therefore, the content makes you suspicious. Then the context. The context is worse. The context today is the Assam NRC. After the Assam NRC, and 19,06,657 people declared stateless, we are questioning the motives and the bona fides of this government. So that is frightening people. In one state, you have identified 19,06,657 people as stateless people. Suppose this exercise is done all over India, what will happen? And who are these people?
Sir, I'll
tell
you.
Most of them are poor people. Mm-hmm.
You all are explaining it well, and all processes and everything is being debated. Many people say that it is very simple. It is an exercise possibly to do voter suppression.
I don't know about voter suppression. Clearly, the 19,06,657 in Assam will not be given the right to vote. So they have been declared stateless. Now, if you do that all over India, it will throw up a humongous amount. Number will be, what, 3 crore, 4 crore, 5 crore, I don't know. And where will you send these people? What will you do with them?
One doesn't have to send anyone. Just don't vote. I'm okay.
Well, which is perhaps a sinister design, because half of them in Assam are Muslims. Anyway, whether they are Muslims or Hindus is one thing. Bulk of them are poor. See, today, the Prime Minister's degree certificate cannot be traced from Delhi University. The former HRD Minister's degree certificate cannot be traced. Now, how do you expect a poor villager in Assam who has floods once a year, wipes away everything, how does he trace a certificate? Suppose you ask me today, go get your school leaving certificate. Where do I go?
True. Sir, आपने भी बोला कि 3-4 करोड़ हिंदू मुसलमान गरीब जो भी हों, बहुत लोगों को ऐसा लगता है कि जब ये इतनी बड़ी पोलराइजिंग बात हो गई तब मेनस्ट्रीम पार्टी स्पेशली लेड बाय कांग्रेस पार्टी को माइनॉरिटीज़ के साथ मुसलमान के साथ जिस तरीके से कन्विक्शन के साथ खुल के खड़ा होना चाहिए आप लोगों के यहाँ बड़ा हिसाब किताब हो रहा है हिंदुत्व सॉफ्ट हिंदुत्व हिंदू नाराज़ हो जाएगा बड़ा रॉन्ग कैलकुलेशन है वो
आई डोंट शेयर द सॉफ्ट हिंदुत्व We have to stand up for every Indian. If he happens to be a Muslim, let him be a Muslim. If he happens to be a Sikh, if he happens to be a Hindu, if he happens to be a Christian, let him be so. We have to stand up for every Indian. There is no soft Hindutva. I don't believe in soft Hindutva. Religion is a private matter. You can pray to whoever you like. You can follow whatever faith you like. It's a private matter between you and your God. There is nothing to do with standing up for India as we see India. I mean, I can't imagine India without Muslims, without Sikhs, without Christians. How can you imagine in India without Hindi, Tamil, Telugu, Kannada? How can you imagine India without Diwali, Christmas, Bakrid? This is India. And if that India is being challenged by the BJP, RSS, it's the duty of every Indian to fight. And I'm so proud that young students and youth are coming out and fighting.
I want again to go back to some economic issues, but before that I want to ask one question about our judiciary in the context of two issues. One, Kashmir 370 internet ban, and the second is a protest where so-called violence took place and then court made some observation. In terms of content and in terms of sense of urgency, how is our legal system approaching these issues?
See, I think on Kashmir, they should have heard the case on a day-to-day basis and delivered judgment even in the month of August. See, the lockdown started on the night of August 4-5. The judgment has come on January 10, 2020. These are habeas corpus petitions were filed. They have not still been heard. I think the Kashmir was a grave issue, a grave challenge to India's rule of law, liberty, issues of liberty, not issues of bread butter, issue of liberty. I think the cases should have been heard in August and judgment should have been delivered in August. So that sense, I was disappointed that it dragged on for 6 months. The judgment is clear. The legal principles are fantastic, but no relief has been granted to anybody. Maybe there will be another judgment.
Is it also not a very, very grave and big concern for all Indians if legal system is not responding with the speed and urgency?
I agree. Even on CAA, the case should be heard quickly. Please remember, the demonetization case has never been heard. We all challenge demonetization.
What can be done to make sure that Supreme Court is also very sensitive about its duty?
See, Supreme Court is indeed sensitive. It won't be fair to say Supreme Court is not sensitive. But they have too much on their plate. They've got Sabarimala, they've got CAA, they've got Kashmir, they've got all kinds of cases land up. That is because the high courts are not sharing their part of the burden. If many of these cases should be heard and end in the High Court. The High Court should be able to decide many of these matters.
Prime Minister recently said in the same meeting that economy has the capacity to bounce back. Some people are seeing some green shoots in different spaces.
I've heard this for 6 quarters. Next quarter will be all right. Next quarter will be all right.
So are we in for this downward spiral for 1 more year or 2 years?
No.
Just 2 quarters?
If they do something now in this budget, it will take 6 months to show results. So at least for the next 2 quarters, we are in trouble. If they had done something 6 months earlier, you'll see the result now. Mm-hmm. So not having done anything in the last year, 2019-20, let me assume they will do something on February 1. The benefit will be seen only after August, September.
So 2021 could be a waste year, but
2021 calendar year will be, bulk of calendar 2021 will be wasted.
So 21-22, we will start seeing various kind of upticks?
I don't know what they do. They do the wrong things. For example, you said they will cut personal income tax rate. I think it's a wrong thing to do.
They should cut indirect taxes.
They should cut indirect taxes. But if they do the wrong thing, what can I do?
Many experts are writing about transparency in the budget numbers. What would you have to say about
See,
that?
See, we all welcome transparency. Every minister has, including me, has hidden some numbers. I'm not denying that. I'm not denying that. Exigencies are like that. But this government has gone beyond all limit. This government has
crossed all limit. Is this first time you are admitting that you have hidden
some
numbers?
No, I've admitted it before. I myself said there are off-budget borrowings.
Right.
And the analyst and the rating agency takes that into account.
So, same mistakes at a scale.
But scale makes a difference, na? Scale makes a difference. It's a very different thing for me to do this. It's a very different thing if I take a stick and beat your head. That's a scale. But it makes a big difference. Yes. You roll over some bills of the Food Corporation of India. You roll over some bills of the Indian Oil Corporation. That is all right. 1 or 2 months you can adjust it. It will show up again. If it doesn't show up in March 31, it will show up in June 30. But these guys are doing a wholesale, which is what is questionable. And they have changed the base year, which is okay. They have changed the methodology. They've changed the deflator, so much so, for the first time, our numbers are not being believed in the world. In the UPA time, our numbers were believed with some adjustment on the off-budget borrowing. But nobody believes their numbers. Even Indian economists abroad don't believe the government of India's numbers. We are being compared to China 6 years ago.
Now, if they come up with a very serious disinvestment or privatization plan, will that be enough looking at the banking situation which is reaching nowhere?
No. Why are they privatizing? They must tell me that first. See, privatization is not a panacea for the problems. Privatization must have a goal. I can understand if you say, I want to privatize Air India. Because Air India is a perennial, perpetual loss maker. I cannot run an airline. Let a private person come and run an airline. I understand that. Why should he privatize an oil company? But why? You must give a reason. Na?
So, how will they mobilize resources?
Just because you mobilize, want to mobilize resources, you privatize. Privatization must have a purpose. If the purpose is correct, you privatize. Mobilizing resources requires an understanding of the macroeconomy. How is the macroeconomy behaving? What will demand be? What will supply be? What will trade, exports, etc. be? Where will incomes rise? What can I tax? Now, if you don't understand the macroeconomy, you will not be able to raise revenues. They are failure to raise revenues, not only this year. Even last year they fell short. The previous year also they fell short. Every year, their marksmanship is the worst of any government. Worst. That is because they don't understand how the macro economy functions.
Sir, this is an accusation that they don't understand. One standpoint is, they understand but it is not their priority.
No, I don't agree. Their priority is Hindutva, that is, assume economy is second priority or third priority. Even the third priority, they don't understand the macro economy. There is a serious lack of talent in the government. So the answer is very simple. If you don't have talent, hire talent. There are any number of Indians in India and abroad who are completely competent to come and run the economy for you, or at least advise you or occupy key positions.
So, one biggest pain point or the result of all this is the serious unemployment and the loss of existing jobs.
It'll get worse.
Why would you say that?
It'll get worse because as businesses begin to deleverage, shed debt, shed employees is inevitable. Look at Oyo. Oyo has already got rid of 1,000 people. The software sector alone has got rid of several lakh people. Automobile sector has got rid of several lakh people. Once you're deleveraging and shedding debt, you're bound to shed jobs. In fact, the State Bank of India, somebody put out a report saying...
Yeah, 16 lakh.
15 lakh jobs will be lost this year.
Yeah. And the bigger hit will be on the informal sector.
Yes.
So, but reviving jobs in informal sector, using construction sector as a delivery agent, are easy ones.
No, but they are better than no job. No? See, if the all option is no jobs at all, it's much better to have casual, irregular, informal jobs in the construction sector, in the service sector, delivery sector, in the SMS, small and medium SMEs, is better than not having a job. I agree. Ideally, you must have a regular job in the manufacturing, organized sector with Provident Fund, ESI, security, leave laws, etc. That is ideal. But if you don't have those jobs, it's much better to have at least these jobs as a substitute. Otherwise, joblessness will increase in this country.
Sir, last question. This is a fact that government cannot really drive growth. Private sector has to do it. But the relationship with the private sector is totally damaged. And more
Completely.
Than that,
Completely.
More than that, the total kind of total killing of entrepreneurial spirit is now a known fact. They have to revive that confidence.
No, they have to change their attitude. You see, Mr. Modi is essentially a controller. He is not an instinctive liberalizer. He's a controller. He likes to control everything, regulate everything. Which is why they've given extraordinary powers to the Income Tax Department, Excise Department, Customs Department, to the agencies. And each one has gone berserk. Each one is issuing notices left and right. Retrospective taxation, reopen returns for 10 years, 6 years, bring that account, bring this account. I mean, what's going on? Therefore, businesses are scared. Businesses are scared to touch anything. They say, all right, we are sitting on piles of cash. Why should we now take the trouble of starting anything new? Now we'll sit on cash. Mm-hmm. They are declaring dividends. They are deleveraging, paying off their debt. They are right-sizing, but they're not investing.
And what do you hear from foreign investors?
Foreign investors are investing in the stock market. It's FII. It's not FDI. They're investing in the stock market. Stock market is booming. Every day you
see. And there is a new kind of polarization in stock market. Only few shares of Nifty.
Yeah, because there's only 50 and 100 shares are being counted. So stock market booms, you say stock market touches new high, stock market touches new high. What has this got to do with the reality on the ground? The reality on the ground is the millions of jobs which are dependent upon the small and medium enterprises. That is not reflected in the stock market and nobody is investing money there. Look at the credit growth. Credit growth to industry is negative. Credit growth to small industry is negative. It's only personal loans which are making credit growth positive. It's positive by a very small amount.
Small amount. Sir, this is very strange. Now there is no liquidity problem with the banking system, especially...
No, I don't think so.
PSU banking. Still, they are not able to lend at all. What does it tell us?
Now people nobody are wants tired, to borrow, no?
People are tired discussing PSU banks and NBFC crisis.
Nobody wants to borrow. Why would I borrow?
And you don't expect at all from the budget that they will do something where
they
we start
have to.
Borrowing and...
They have to do it. What they will do, I can't say. I'm told they are contemplating a development finance institution like the old ICICI, IDBI. I don't know. They're contemplating... I don't know what they're... infrastructure spending.
Yeah, they have come up with a very big timetable on infrastructure spending.
See, this is, everybody loves a famine. You saw a book. Everybody loves public works. In this country, everybody likes the public works department. Giving away tenders and bids and public works is the best way to spend money.
So government spending alone just can't...
It won't, but it'll help. Unless there is private investment and private consumption, this economy will not turn. The four engines of growth, the most important two engines are private investment, private consumption. Exports and government expenditure are two other engines. But according to me, the two more important engines are, if it's a front wheel drive car, the two front wheels are private investment and private consumption. Both are dead today.
Let's see what Finance Minister does on 1st February, and then we shall again talk to you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.